canyons ever widening in the depths of her cold heart. So she sets out on another misadventure just to find she's another 2 years older and she's three more steps behind. Does anybody hear her? Can anybody see? Or does anybody even know she's going down today? Under the shadow of our steeple, with all the lost and lonely people searching for the hope that's tucked away in you and me. Does anybody hear her? Can anybody see? She is yearning for shelter and affection that she never found at home. She is searching for a hero to ride in to save the day. And in walks her Prince Charming, and he knows just what to say. Momentary lapse of reason, and she gives herself away. Glances from lofty people, you can't see past a scarlet letter, and we never even met her. If judgment looms under every steeple, if lofty glances from lofty people, you can't see past a scarlet letter.
All right, good evening. Wow, this is powerful. You can hear me. Well, good evening. Welcome to the October 2018 Distinguished Lecture Series. My name is Jeff Hunt, and I'm the Vice President of Public Policy here at Colorado Christian University, and I have the privilege of being able to direct our think tank, the Centennial Institute. This is our monthly lecture series featuring our brightest minds on the most challenging issues of our time. And tonight we'll be exploring how to help a family member with drug addiction. To begin our evening, please stand and welcome 1776 scholars Kendall Patterson and Ethan Swain to lead us in prayer and the Pledge of Allegiance.
Dear Lord, thank you for this time and thank you for bringing all of these people out to hear our distinguished lectures. Thank you for this brisk autumn day, and please bless this time that we have together. Make it a transformative time and an informative time, and please use these speakers to speak your truth to everyone that is here. In Jesus' name, amen.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands,
Thank you. You may be seated. All right. Peter, Paul, why don't you guys come on up? Peter, Paul, we just need Mary, right? I think we got everybody. Well, they're grabbing a seat. I'll introduce our evening. The issue of drug addiction is very personal to me, as it is to many Coloradans. Not only did I lose those closest to me as a result of drug use, but I was a regular user of marijuana in high school. And the more I used drugs, the more I watched my grades slip, my relationships with my friends and family disintegrate. For me, it was the saving grace of Jesus Christ that rescued me from the drug lifestyle. The truth is, we have a drug culture problem in Colorado and America. I asked President Sweeting, who's the president of Colorado Christian University, about the Centennial Institute taking on marijuana. Now, I told him we were getting a lot of heat and from the press and from the marijuana industry as a result of our work. He told me, Jeff, we are tasked with shepherding the minds of the next generation to fulfill their God-given potential. And illicit drugs get in the way of what people can achieve with their lives. Now, most of the events we host here are public policy based, but tonight I wanted our distinguished lecture series to provide tangible steps we can all take to help those experiencing a drug addiction. In 2017, more people died in Colorado of drug overdose than at any point in our state's history. Deaths from methamphetamines have exploded. Deaths from heroin and cocaine have remained well above where they were just 2 years ago. In fact, the Denver Post reports that altogether, drug overdoses in Colorado killed more people last year than car crashes. In Colorado, opioid and methamphetamine deaths are at an all-time high. 959 people died in Colorado last year from drug poisoning, which is another is how the how they record drug overdose deaths, a figure that includes both intentional and unintentional drug overdoses. In 2000, for comparison, drug poisonings claimed fewer than 400. We've gone from 400 to nearly 1,000 in the last 18 years. My hope tonight is that we can begin the process of changing our culture, that we can get that we can help those closest to us live to their fullest God-given capacities. To guide our panel tonight is my good friend, Peter Droege. Peter and his wonderful wife, Jan, have four great kids and are active members in their church and the local community. He is the fellow of marijuana and drug addiction policy at the Centennial Institute and is helping us develop a long-term strategy to protect Colorado's youth and communities from the harms of legalized marijuana and other drugs, increase access to treatment and recovery programs, advising us on appropriate policy strategies, and he does media interviews and writes op-eds for national publications, including USA Today. During the day, he serves as president of Digital Continent, LLC, a cause marketing and communications firm serving mission-driven nonprofits. For the purpose of tonight's gathering, one of his key clients is the Wyoming's Association of Sheriffs and Chiefs of Police, who have engaged him to do education and prevention programs designed to respond to efforts to introduce legalized marijuana in the state of Wyoming. After 10 years of serving as the Vice President of Communications for the Daniels Fund, Peter was asked to take over Step Denver, then Step 13, to help address financial and programmatic issues following the unexpected death of its founder, Bob Cote. You'll learn more about this great organization tonight from Paul Scudo, right over there, the Executive Director of Step Denver. So please join me in welcoming Peter. We'll turn it over to you, Peter.
Thank you, Jeff. Well, Jeff, thank you very much. I'm honored to work with Jeff and everyone at the Centennial Institute. I knew Bill Armstrong fairly well, and I think he really was the measure of a man in our culture. And I know we all miss him greatly. And so it is an honor to be affiliated in any way with his legacy, and especially with Jeff and the Centennial Institute. When I was at the Daniels Fund, part of what I did was compile information about Bill Daniels, and probably many of you know something about Bill Daniels and what an incredible figure he was, One of the things I did was gather a lot of the video footage in which he spoke and compiled it and made sure that it was preserved for the long term. And one of the things that surprised me about Bill was that in any number of videos, when he was introduced as one of the world's leading business figures, as a man of unsurpassed character, ethics, honesty, integrity, really as the man who was the driving force behind cable television, he would very often get up in front of the microphone and thank the person who had introduced him. But then he would say, "Now let me tell you who I really am." And he would say, "I'm an alcoholic, and I've been sober for, however many years at that time." And I was always deeply impressed by that. And I thought, well, since Bill could do that, I can do it too. So I'm also an alcoholic. And I got into recovery 26 years ago, and just consider with great gratitude that time. For those of us in recovery, just knowing what an incredible gift it is, I have nothing but gratitude for my recovery. I never take it for granted, because recovery, it isn't addiction isn't a character issue. Addiction is really just a tremendous burden and a challenge that we face and our loved ones face. So I'm just so honored to be able to carry on this legacy here. I'm going to just give very, very brief comments. What I'm going to do is just give an overview framework of how I approach recovery. And then I'm going to just go through the 12 steps very quickly, because for anyone here who has a friend or a coworker or a loved one who's going through recovery, those 12 steps, while it's not the only path to recovery, they do offer a very clear, it helps, I think, give insights into the process that a person in addiction has to go through in order to come out and to really get into recovery. So the first thing I would say is with a loved one, number one, you just think about how would our Lord, for those of us who are Christians, how would our Lord Jesus respond to someone in addiction? And clearly he would just respond with love and mercy. And so that's how we have to approach those who are in recovery. We have to love them and to be merciful to them. But there also has to be a logic that goes along with that love. If you have someone who's really struggling, there needs to be some measure of accountability that isn't based on condemnation or judgment, but rather a clear logical framework for consequences for behaviors, and you have to be able to stick to those. And these guys are going to talk quite a bit more about that with a lot more expertise than I can. So I'll just leave it to them. It has to be a disciplined love. So now, again, to get into the 12 steps, I'm just going to go through these very quickly. The first step is an ultimate acceptance of powerlessness over addiction. It's a hard place to be, because you never get there without often losing so much. And so whether you call it hitting bottom or accepting that we were powerless over our addiction. Step two, to come to recognize that there is a power greater than ourselves that can restore us to sanity. The substance that we're addicted to is not that higher power. There's a higher power that can lead us to sanity. It ain't us. There's something else, something greater, something more powerful than us that can help us and will help us. That we make that decision to turn our lives over to the care of God as we understand Him. That loving God that truly is efficacious. He has the power to help us. Next, to make a searing and fearless moral inventory of ourselves. You know what? Looking in the mirror, it ain't easy. It ain't easy for those of us who have gotten caught up in addiction to have done things that really hurt people. I'm not talking hypothetical. I mean really hurting our loved ones or our friends or people that we didn't even know. That moral inventory is absolutely essential. essential and incredibly difficult. Admitting to God and to ourselves, and importantly, another human being, the exact nature of our wrongs. Again, not easy. Not easy to do that, but being able to just simply be honest. To be ready to have God remove those defects, to have faith, to know that it's possible. May not seem, you know, likely given our experience, but God is more powerful than we can imagine. God can do it, you know, and to come to that acceptance. Then to make a list of all the persons we had harmed and be willing to make amends to them. I'm sorry. Well, thank you, Jeff.
Got my help here.
So that is a very difficult process. A lot of people spend a lot of time on this step because you dig deep and you realize all the people that you've hurt. And next is to make amends to those people. That's something that, again, is very difficult. Sometimes it's not possible. The people we hurt may not even be in our lives anymore, or we may have done things that were so hurtful that they don't even want to see us. So that is an incredible. It may not be possible to do that, but where it's possible, we're obligated to do that. Then it's the process to continue that process and to continue to take that moral inventory and to recognize those prompts, those triggers that are going to lead us back to that behavior, and to immediately surrender them to God. Don't let them take us down the same pathway to relapse and to burning down our lives again. You know, it's the very important process. Number 11, through prayer and meditation, improve our relationship with God as we understand him, to really have an authentic prayer life, to really allow him to touch our hearts and our souls and to be a part of our lives, to give us his strength to carry out that recovery. And then finally, as you know, here I am tonight, you know, as an alcoholic, what am I doing tonight? But step 12, I'm honored to be able to be here to continue that awakening by carrying that message to others. So again, it's really an honor to be with you tonight. Without further ado, I want to introduce our next speaker. Kent McLennan is the executive director for Rise Above Colorado. And I want to say, what an incredible panel we have here tonight. We're so fortunate to have these folks here. And I think by the end of the night, you're going to see why what I'm saying. So Kent is the executive director of Rise Above Colorado. It's a statewide drug prevention organization that aims to empower teens to live a life free of drug abuse. Rise Above Colorado creates proactive, youth-focused outreach and education programs to help teens learn about the risks of drug abuse, hopefully getting them before they get into it, right? So he previously served as director of the Colorado Meth Project. For anyone who's familiar with that organization, there are lives that were saved by this guy and by that organization, by helping young people avoid the disaster of methamphetamines. So Kent pretty much ran everything associated with that organization. He has more than 20 years of leadership experience in the nonprofit sector. He spent 15 years in the development field for youth serving and educational organizations, including Young American Center for Financial Education, which was also founded by Bill Daniels, and that was where we met, and the University of Denver and Up With People. So Kent, it's my honor to turn it over to you, and just want to ask everyone to welcome.
Great. Good evening, everyone. Thanks for having me here. I'm pleased to be here as well with a great panel of folks that I consider experts in this field. I want to start and try to give a little bit of context from a youth prevention perspective. And Peter introduced the organization. I'll tell you a little bit more, but I want to give you some context using some data and pretty recent data to help us get a sense of the scope of the issue. And what I would really say is, as you look at this data, I would couch it as that we are talking about issues of hope and concern that you'll see throughout these data points. There are elements of real hope in it, and there are absolutely elements of concern that go with some of the data points of what we're seeing and what our youth are facing in today's world. The first of which, you may not be able to read that kind of light blue on the screen, but this is a data point from the National Institute of Drug Abuse in which 90% of addictions start in the teenage years. And I say that meaning they don't necessarily manifest themselves in those years, but the roots of those addictions that may take place later in life really form during those teenage years. And I think one of the major things that can account for that is the adolescent developing brain that really isn't fully developed until the age of about 25. We have one of the actual great experts in Dr. Thurstone here that could tell you the real detail that I can't in terms of the brain science, but this is hard science. And it's something that our youth really respond to, but it's important to know that these are a time period of great opportunity, incredible development that takes place in the adolescent years, but also it comes with that an incredible risk as well, depending on the choices that our youth make. So kind of framing that discussion. So our organization, as Peter alluded to, we're really focused on empowering youth and giving them the skills and the tools to make healthy choices. Our organization grew out of the Colorado Meth Project, as Peter referred to. That organization, I'm pleased to say, is still going. You and I don't see it very much, like the billboard and advertising campaign that took place from around 2009, 2011, pretty heavily. Our youth still see it in online advertising, and so there's still pretty strong awareness of the campaign and the Not Even Once message that goes with it. We've expanded in 2014 to really expand our focus, taking what we learned about communicating with youth around the issue of meth prevention and expanding that more broadly. We saw a major issue taking place, and it's the opioid epidemic that we are all really trying to come to grips with and seeing on a regular basis in our news broadcasts and in our communities. So that was something that we really wanted to try to take on and specifically address, and we'll tell you a little bit about how we're doing some of that. And then also really broaden our message to include what can we encourage, what positive messaging can we instill in our youth about the healthy choices that most youth really do make, and we'll talk about that in a little bit as well. In terms of, I want to help you define prevention the way that we as an organization see it. And the work that we're doing, there's lots of elements of prevention and things that are preventive steps that are helping us, but what we're really focused on is primary prevention, and what it is that we hope that we are instilling in our youth is strategies that really take place at the broader community and societal cultural levels. So a lot of that through messaging. Youth see us and interact with us on digital media and social media, a place where there's a lot of influences, both positive and negative. And we want to be a source for some legitimate, trusted information about substance use. What we're hoping to do is impart some knowledge, increase and measurably impact their knowledge on a variety of topics. Rent mentioned the teen brain science, mental health and promoting good mental health, appropriate, inappropriate use of substances that are legal, like prescription drugs. We want to teach some skills, whether that's skills about how to navigate a very, very difficult social media climate, building those media literacy skills, whether healthy decision making, refusal skills. Some of these things we do through our digital and social media communication, but some of it we do through the youth-serving organizations that we work with at a community level to try to get the interaction that they have directly with young people at a face-to-face level and give them some of the tools to help their young people make these good choices. And ultimately, if we increase knowledge and skills, then we have the opportunity to impact and shape attitudes. And if we're impacting and positively shaping attitudes among youth that might increase their perception of harm or risk of using a substance, whether it's meth or misuse of prescription drugs or whatever the substance is. If we're able to do that, then over time, the idea is that we can change behavior and that we can impact making those actual decisions whether to use or not to use. And as I said, we do this through communications. We also do it through peer engagement. So we work with youth. We have a teen advisory council made up of young people in middle school and high school from across the state that work with us as real peer advocates and educators in their own communities. And then we work with youth-serving partner organizations. So I'll give you a sense of how we work with some of the communities. And this particular slide describes our work on prescription drug abuse prevention. Across the state, we created what we call a Colorado Constellation Project and worked with and selected 9 different communities that were high risk and had significant challenges on the prescription drug front from a variety of different data points, and then worked with communities also where we found partner organizations that wanted to engage in this work with us, whether they were already doing it or whether it was something that they wanted to start. And so we helped to support some of these communities. So it's really taking some statewide resources that we as an organization have, that we partner with another statewide entity called the Colorado Consortium on Prescription Drug Abuse Prevention that really takes a holistic approach in impacting the issues of prescription drug misuse and addiction. As you may know, if we were to talk more specifically about that, it is really a multifaceted challenge that we're up against with this opioid epidemic. It requires youth prevention. It requires every other step of the process. It requires the support of law enforcement. We work around treatment, recovery, preventing, creating safe disposal options. I could go on and on in terms of the different ways that we have to impact that particular issue in order to have success in changing the landscape for our citizens in Colorado. So that's a little bit of how we've organized our work, particularly around prescription drugs. I want to share some data with you specific to Colorado that I think, again, you'll find some areas of hope and some of concern. We've been working on this prescription drug issue for about 4 years as an organization, and that was about a year before that was when our governor set out a plan for trying to reduce prescription drug misuse amongst folks that were 12 and over. He wanted to see if we could cut that number by about 92,000 citizens that were misusing prescription drugs. And I'll tell you that we're not there yet. We are seeing some positive shifts in that trend, however. From a youth perspective specifically, the first bullet point there we're looking at, we have seen a significant decline in the use of prescription pain relievers among high schoolers. This is data from the Healthy Kids Colorado survey. This is fresh data, and it's an enormous sample size, more than 40,000, I believe, of our high school youth that were surveyed across the state in late 2017. This data came out this summer. It's down 24% from where it was in 2015. That's good news that we're making a statistically significant change in use among our youth. And I think going with that, one of the things that we really look at from a prevention perspective is the fact that if we can increase perception of risk of using a drug, that typically will result over time in a decrease in the actual use. And that's one of the things that we've seen in a time period between 2016 and 2018, where the perception of youth that saw great risk in misusing a prescription pain reliever, so we're talking about Oxycontin, Vicodin, Percocet, oxycodone, those types of substances, that increased 35% during that 2-year period. That was a significant spike the right way, the way we wanted it. And so we're seeing that move in the right direction. And I have to think the amount of press coverage and conversation that's taken place about the issue and all of the lives that have been impacted has had a positive impact on our youth. We've seen that in our survey significantly more youth recognize that prescription pain relievers are just as dangerous and addictive as street drugs, specifically heroin. These are synthetic forms of heroin, and we need to treat them as such that if they're not prescribed for you, there are significant risks that can occur. And we're also pleased that through some of the campaign work that we've done, that we saw that youth who are aware of the campaigns and the messaging that we do are less curious to misuse prescription drugs and more likely to discourage their friends from using. And so that positive peer influence is a real thing and can be a positive factor. A few other data points on other substances that I thought I would share as well that coming from this recent data. We referenced meth and our work with the Meth Project. There's good news on that front among youth, despite the fact that this drug, and I think Jeff alluded to it earlier, the fact that the overdose deaths are up for methamphetamine. It continues to be readily available, highly addictive, and now even more deadly than it has been previously. Teen meth use is actually going in the right direction. It's gone down. It's down to 2% of youth in this Healthy Kids survey report that they've actually used meth in their lifetime. That's half of what it was when we started the Meth Project back in 2009. So we've seen a real positive shift and trending downward, that youth are getting the message and making a good choice, despite the fact that this is out there and continuing to create trouble for adults. So that's good news that we can take from this. Marijuana obviously continues to be a challenge for us. And despite the fact that that use remains stable, multiple data sources have shown that despite during the time since legalization, use amongst teens is stable. However, it's still among the top five in the nation, no matter how you slice the data. We still rank in the very top among use for marijuana among youth. And the other concerning factor is because this is being normalized amongst adults, that the perception of risk continues to fall in using marijuana. We're down only 60% see a great risk in regular use of marijuana. That was down from 71% in 2016. That portends that we could have some concerns moving forward because of this normative behavior. And the other thing that really concerns us is the age in which people start using. Half of the folks that responded in this survey said they first tried it when they were between 12 and 14. And if we talk to Dr. Thurstone about the age of first use and the impact, the earlier you start with substances, the greater the risk of addiction that takes place. And that's one of the things that really concerns us. Finally, to wrap up on some of this data, family discussions around some substances like prescription drugs is increasing. There's more dialogue amongst parents and youth, and we talk about the parent element of this conversation. That's good. It's up to from 32% to 51% today, but it's not enough. We're still not having that conversation at the rate that we are about alcohol and marijuana. And Jeff referenced the conversation that so many of us as parents of teenagers have about drunk driving. And the fact is that there are twice as many overdose deaths as there are drunk driving fatalities. And yet, you know, we talk a lot, and rightly so, about drunk driving, but we're not having enough of these conversations with our youth about the risks of overdose from substances like prescription pain relievers. So I would tell you the timing of when we're doing this prevention work is critical. That data point about marijuana tells us we've got to be in middle schools having these conversations and talking with our young people when they're middle school age, because we want them to be prepared for the transition that takes place when they go to high school. That's one of the biggest risk periods when the access and the curiosity increase, offers for to use substances, and the actual use themselves, all those double in that time period of that transition year of 14 to 15. So we want to change those misperceptions. So one of the things that we're currently working on as an organization is really focusing on some positive social norms. So the data point that you'll see that on the football jerseys and next to it is we're trying to emphasize the fact that most teens are making good choices when it comes to substance use, and emphasizing the positive norms instead of emphasizing the negative of how many youth are using. We want youth to feel comfortable that they don't have to succumb to peer pressure to use, because the vast majority of their peers are not. Whatever the substance is, whether it's alcohol, marijuana, prescription drugs, they're not using, and we want them to have that strength of knowing the positive statistics that really most aren't using, and you know, really to stick to their convictions to make those good choices. So the attempt with this campaign is, can we close the gap between what teens perceive, that everybody's doing it mentality, and can we get less youth to overestimate use amongst their peers so that we can bring that back in line with what the reported use actually is? And if so, over time, that's been proven to have an impact on use amongst youth. And the good news is that we're starting to see some of those trends already. We've been at this campaign for about a year, and some of the early data that we're seeing is significantly fewer middle school students are overestimating use amongst their peers. That's good news. It's amazing the number of youth that misperceive use every substance except marijuana that's taking place, and I think we probably know why some of that the challenges with marijuana exist. So that's something that we're really we're pleased about. So we can talk more about any of those questions, but I wanted to leave you, just before we pass it off to Dr. Thurstone, some resources, and he's going to talk about more specific resources for you, but there are a variety of different places that folks can get help. It's not the work necessarily of our organizations, but there's a number of partner organizations. Speak Now has a website that's built for parents to get answers on how to have the conversation on whatever the subject is. It's age appropriate depending on the age of your young person, so that they can have those conversations. There's obviously crisis services resources as well. We partner with a national organization, the Partnership for Drug-Free Kids, that has counseling to help parents navigate when they think their son or daughter may be using, and how to get help at the stage that they're at. So there are a variety of different resources out there that I would encourage you to seek out to help increase those conversations.
So, terrific. Kent, thank you very much. And I do want to mention there will be time for questions at the end. We've set aside quite a bit of time, so please be thinking about any questions that you may have for any of our speakers. I think a key point that Kent just made is none of us can do this alone. That if you have a loved one, a friend, or a coworker who is struggling with addiction, no way you can do it alone. You got to get help. And that's a big part of the reason why we're doing this event here tonight, is to begin to help make all of you and everyone else more aware of the resources that are out there to enable, to help you and others really walk with those folks that are struggling with addiction. And it's now my honor to introduce Dr. Christian Thurstone. Dr. Thurstone is one of about three dozen physicians in the United States who are board certified in general child and adolescence and addictions psychiatry. So that's really an amazing accomplishment. He's the medical director of one of Colorado's largest youth substance treatment programs and an associate professor of psychiatry at the University of Colorado, Denver, where he conducts research on youth substance use and addiction and serves as director of medical training for the university's addiction psychiatry fellowship program. Dr. Thurstone is past president of the Colorado Child and Adolescent Psychiatric Society. He completed medical training at the University of Chicago, Northwestern University, and the University of Colorado at Denver. Dr. Thurstone.
Great. Thank you.
Great. Thank you so much for inviting me to be here, and thanks to the panelists. This is a great discussion. Let's see here. I was going to go through my top 10 list of things that parents can do to help adolescents, young adults with an addiction or who are starting to dabble in this. That is kind of my wheelhouse. I'm an adult doctor, but I also, my real specialty of research is adolescence and adolescent addiction, and for young adults. And so I actually wrote a book here, Clearing the Haze. And so if somebody wants this afterwards, and you think you might read it and benefit from it, just come get me and I'd be happy to give this copy away. So in researching for this book, I read a million articles and kind of distilled to the top 10 things that parents can do to be helpful. So the first one up there, yeah, there it is. Be caring, empathic, emotionally responsive. So there's nothing that replaces that positive, warm, loving relationship. That's how kids grow up, to take on our values that you have as an adult. Doesn't mean we're like buddy-buddy, best friends type of thing, but it does mean there's this warm, caring relationship. And so that's number one. Be authoritative. So there's authoritative parenting, there's authoritarian, there's passive. Passive is like, okay, go do whatever you want. Authoritarian is like, it's my way or the highway, I don't care what you think. And then authoritative is kind of somewhere in between, where I can understand why you would want to go to the mountains with your friends with no adult supervision, and I don't feel comfortable with that, okay? So that would be authoritative. We try to shoot for that authoritative ground. Behavioral control, not psychological control. So behavioral control is basically rewards, consequences. Gee, thank you for doing your homework tonight. You know, you can have an extra hour of curfew because you did all your chores, something like that. Psychological control would be, don't you know what you're doing to your mother and me? Or like, don't you know what you're doing to the family? Or why can't you be more like your big sister, your older sister, things like that. We're laughing because as parents, we've all fallen into this trap and we just need to be good enough, not perfect, right? Good enough as parents. That's all we can hope for. And by the way, parents can do everything perfectly. I see this all the time and have a child who grows up with an addiction. So I see it all the time. And I see a lot of mothers, especially with a lot of guilt. And I think that's not so helpful because, again, we're doing the best we can with what we have and we're trying to be good enough. Let's see here. So self-care, boundaries, co-parenting. So put on your own oxygen mask first and then put on everybody else's oxygen mask, okay? Don't forget to take care of yourself. Spending time together, I think that's self-explanatory. Be a healthy role model for your own, obviously, substance intake. So parents who smoke and use substances more likely to have children who smoke and use substances. But that also has to do with just a general healthy life in terms of whatever it is for different people. Clear expectations about substance use. So parents, caregivers, you may think that your teenager doesn't care what you think about this, but they actually do. Okay, so please make it clear what you think and what your expectations are for your household. Even if you're going to get, oh, mom, oh, dad, right? It still a little bit does get through the surface. And I'm always surprised at how many kids come to treatment with me and they say, oh, yeah, my dad doesn't care. He told me how he smoked weed in college and he turned out great, right? So he doesn't care. So I think it's important to make the expectation clear. Require teens to contribute to household functioning. So I think that, you know, teaches responsibility. It also helps people feel important when they have a role in the family functioning, like they're contributing. Using extended family is helpful and help youth have meaning and purpose. So meaning and purpose, whether that's chess club or sports or something pro-social, very helpful. And religiosity is actually very protective for substance use. So involvement in some kind of religious spiritual development can be very helpful. That's my top 10. It's in my book here, and which is explained in more detail with references. And I wanted to go through, do I have just a couple minutes?
Oh, you
is
bet.
That okay? Yeah. Okay, all right. Do I have a couple minutes? Okay, all right, you're pointing at your watch. I'm getting nervous. Okay, so let's see here. Just as a physician, I wanted to talk a little bit about some of the medications to treat and some of the medical aspects of addiction. So with the opioid overdose epidemic, we have various treatments now, methadone, buprenorphine, naltrexone, to treat this. And I think it's my opinion, I know there might be some controversy here, but really when we're treating opioid use disorder, alcohol use disorder, it's irresponsible not to have a serious conversation about medications to help treat those things. I believe the backbone of treatment for addiction has always been, is, always will be behavioral interventions and life change, that spiritual transformation. But when it comes to alcohol, opioids, I think there needs to be a serious conversation about medications to treat these. Methadone, first studied since the 1960s for addiction, and so we have, six decades of data now showing it to be a helpful treatment for opioid use disorder. Same with buprenorphine. We've had that now for about just over 10 years. That's a medication you don't have to go to the clinic every day for. A doctor can prescribe a prescription for it. And both methadone and buprenorphine bind to the same receptor as heroin, for example, but without producing the high effect. And I could explain that more in geeky language. Does anybody notice my tie today, the periodic table? So I can get super geeky if you want me to later. But right, they do kind of the same thing, but there's some important differences so that they, when properly dosed, they don't get people high. So it's not just one addiction for another. Let's see here, I have to take my glasses off to see. And then there's a medication, naltrexone, available in a monthly injection, which blocks the effects of heroin and other opioids. So that can also be a really helpful. So that actually does the opposite of heroin. It blocks, if you have this monthly injection and you used heroin, you feel nothing and it's a waste of your time and money. And then I want to talk about Narcan as well. So truthfully, I 90% of the time carry my Narcan kit with me and I open it up and I don't have it in my backpack today. But that reverses overdose, and so that's a big push now to try to get everybody a Narcan kit. So if anybody wants a Narcan kit, come see me afterwards. Give me your name, date of birth, pharmacy telephone number. I'll call it in for you. And the training for it, there's an app called Opie Rescue that teaches you how to use it, or you could contact me and I can help you with that as well. But that is saving lots of, hundreds of lives, getting people Narcan kits. Let's see here. I had a few comments about marijuana too. Thank you, Kent, for stimulating my thoughts around that. You know, it really, marijuana now is not the same substance that was around when in the 60s, 70s, 80s, 90s. It used to be 2 to 3% THC by weight, and now routinely it's 20-plus percent THC by weight. If people are using butane hash oil, it's 90% or more THC by weight. If people are dabbing marijuana, you can YouTube it, dabbing. It's just a totally, totally different way. It's not the same substance at all that we may be thinking of in the good old days. And so really, I think we need to get the message out there that there's no known safe amount of marijuana use in pregnancy. You'd think that we could all agree on that, but actually a recent study showed 70% of bud tenders recommended marijuana to pregnant women in the first trimester. So we need to get that information out. No known safe amount of marijuana use in pregnancy. No known safe amount of marijuana use in adolescence. So thank goodness, vast majority of adolescents who use marijuana turn out just fine. But you see that the prediction, the rates of psychosis and schizophrenia really start going up after 10 exposures to marijuana in adolescents. So that's a finding that we can talk more about later, but has been repeated about a dozen times now since the 1980s, that connection between adolescent marijuana use and subsequent schizophrenia. And the issue is that marijuana binds to the very receptor in the brain that helps control brain development. So hopefully we can get out the information. No, really no known safe amount of marijuana use for adolescents. Brains developing to age 25, as Kent said. And really, can I say something that's probably a little controversial? I truthfully think that I'm not talking about medical use, okay? Setting medical use aside, I don't really think that there's adult recreational use of marijuana that leads to a flourishing life, is my personal opinion around that. So feel free to disagree with me on that. But and why do I think that? I think because marijuana kind of by definition leads to intoxication. I mean, why would you smoke marijuana if you didn't want to get high, right? And so it's the fact that it leads to intoxication that I think is important there. So I think those were my main thoughts, and I'll be eager to hear everybody else's thoughts and questions, comments, concerns at the end. So thank you for your time.
Thank you, Dr. Thurston. Now I'm delighted to introduce Paul Scudo to everyone here. As the executive director for STEP Denver, Paul's responsible for overall oversight and coordination of STEP Denver's men's residential recovery program, including the addiction recovery program, operations, administration, and a vehicle donation business. Paul is a thought leader and role model for addiction recovery in Colorado and beyond. He is also guides men through workforce development and all focused around personal responsibility at STEP Denver. He previously served as recovery sports specialist for the Center for Dependency, Addiction, and Rehabilitation, CEDAR. For those of you who haven't heard of it, it's a terrific program at the University of Colorado Anschutz Medical Center. Prior to that, he was an executive in the hospitality industry. He's also a very good friend. So if you'd please welcome Paul Scudo.
Thank you so much, Peter and Jeff. Thank you for having me again. And again, Kent and Christian, thank you so much for the thoughtful insight. As was mentioned, my name is Paul Scudo, and I am in recovery from the disease of addiction as well. I came from that family that Dr. Thurston described. Perfect parenting, no use, no abuse, all of the opportunities available to me, and yet still I ended up suffering from the disease of addiction. Many of us begin using drugs and alcohol simply because we like the way it feels and because it is a social catalyst between the other, you know, friends in our peer group. And by and large, that's how most of us get started, right? I say that to then say that addiction took everything away from me. I lost everything, a wife, a great job, a home, and ended up being homeless for a number of years. And I say that so that I qualify as someone that is suffering from what many of you or your loved ones are dealing with. As Peter mentioned, I now work as the executive director of STEP Denver Men's Residential Recovery Community. We work helping low-income men to overcome the consequences of addiction through a program that's focused on sobriety, work, and accountability. What we're looking to do is effect a behavioral change by establishing a foundation in addiction recovery, having those individuals become personally responsible for themselves, having them develop themselves in the 8 different areas of wellness, and then having them to become responsible, personally responsible, and accountable for their behaviors, right? We're looking to affect a behavioral change. As was mentioned, addiction is a disease. And the unique thing about this disease is the primary symptom of the disease is that it tells you that you do not have a disease, right? And it tells you that because of the stigma that's associated with the disease of addiction, right? It's embarrassing, it's humiliating. I don't want to be looked at as someone with no willpower or that I am unethical or immoral or I make bad choices or that I'm just a bad person, right? So instinctively, I'm going to tell myself that I don't have a problem and that I can control this. There's also the stigma that surrounds the disease within the community. 90% of the people do not suffer from the disease of addiction and can use drugs or alcohol recreationally. And while that's a completely foreign idea to someone like me, it is the case for most individuals. And thus, they say, hey, Paul, your life is a mess. Why don't you just stop? and they don't understand the chemical reaction that's going on in my brain. And as Dr. Thurstone said, if you want to get with us on the chemistry of that, we'll take off his bow tie and connect the dots. All right. Loved ones also suffer from this disease, right? None of us want to say that we were a bad parent, that we didn't support our loved ones, right? We are genetically wired and programmed to take care of our family, particularly our children, at all costs, right? So I am going to, in many cases, make bad choices, right? It's difficult as a parent to make some difficult choices, right? And no one can tell you what you should or should not do. That is up to you as a parent. At Step Denver, we deal with men 21 years of age and older. They've usually gone through the resources that Kent and Christian have talked about. They've tried the top 10 for parenting, and for some reason or another, treatment or other resources just have not worked with the loved one. And that loved one has gone out, and they've gotten to the point where the consequences are severe enough. Our experience shows that in the majority of the cases, an individual will not seek recovery or a solution until those consequences have become severe enough that there is no hiding them anymore, and also that the folks around them are not supporting the fact that it might be something other than addiction. You know, our quick go-to is mental health, depression, anxiety, things of that nature. And while there are many co-occurring situations, I'm not going to argue that situation, oftentimes there is a misdiagnosis in which the anxiety, depression, and manic depressive symptoms are caused by the addiction and the chemical process going on. But it's very easy for me as a parent to say, oh, my child's depressed, right? That's a much more societally acceptable reason for them using drugs and alcohol, right? Our experience also shows that if an addict is repeatedly rescued from those consequences or is allowed for there to be other reasons for their use, they're going to continue that cycle until the loved one says, or the rest of their peers say, you know what? I think you need to seek help for your addiction. Until everyone is on the same page with the fact that the individual has a problem and that we are not going to rescue or enable or supply the means by which that cycle can continue, the individual is more than likely going to continue to use. And that's difficult because oftentimes an addict will pit the family against each other, right? One parent wants to continue to give, continue to accept, continue that compassionate side that Dr. Thurstone talked about, and the other parent is going to want to move towards the authoritarian or authoritative side and say, no, we're cutting you off, no more resources, and oftentimes there is conflict within the home. And the addict knows how to play that, and oftentimes will play that relationship. Experiences, including my own, show until I'm cut off from those resources, and once I am, the consequences will pile up more quickly. And I will ultimately get to the point where I want recovery in a more timely fashion than I would if I was enabled or those resources continue. And again, this is extremely difficult. How do I just cut off my loved one? How do I, and again, this is after you've tried all of the other resources, right? This is where you've been compassionate. You have tried to work with the individual and those things just aren't happening. How do you cut that person off? It's so difficult, whether it's a child, a wife, a husband, a brother or a sister, a good friend, a coworker, someone that you're emotionally invested in. It is very difficult to say, hey, I love you, and because I love you, I have to stop for your own well-being. You know, that's alien to our psyche. So we just, and I think it was in the same study that Kristen talked about, I heard a woman speak at the Smart Colorado luncheon, and she talked about a story in which she and her husband were at odds with how to take care of their daughter that was addicted to prescription drugs. And the husband wanted to continue to supply her living, continue to give her an apartment and an allowance and bail her out of jail. And the mother wanted to cut her off. And they ultimately got divorced because of that. And unfortunately, that young girl unfortunately died because of that, because there wasn't the utter despair that comes along with, as Peter described, step one, where I admit that I am completely powerless, I cannot hide this anymore, no one is going to take care of me, and my life has become completely unmanageable. And when I get to that point, I often then will have a psychic and a spiritual shift which will allow me to become willing to do whatever is suggested. So how can you help, right? To get the addict the help they need and not just bailed out of consequences. So many times I told my family, oh yeah, I'm ready for help, because there was jail or the loss of my wife, loss of my home, loss of a job. There was a consequence associated with it. I didn't really want the help other than to stay out of trouble, right? But if they are ready, if they've lost everything, and you can tell that they are genuine, get them into a 30 to 90 day treatment program, and then they need long-term extended sober living, and a sober living that has some type of accountability to it, right? Where they have to work full-time, they're getting drug tested, they have to be part of a peer recovery community like the 12 steps or other. They have to have dialogue with the family to rebuild those relationships. And they don't need to do anything else. Provide nothing else for them. Let them work and earn their own living. Most sober livings, you could live in an Oxford house for $500-$600 a month. There are concerned citizens that are right here that run sober living homes at a reasonable cost. You don't need to send them to a $5,000 or $10,000 a month sober living. That's unrealistic, it's too expensive, and oftentimes you're putting them in a situation that's really too nice for where they need to be. Also, do not believe anything that they say. Only believe what they do. Right, and let me step back real quickly. If they are ready for help, there can be no stipulations to the help. Right, if they are resistant in any way to what you suggest, they're not ready. If there are conditions, they're not ready. If there's negotiation, they're not ready. Right, if they are ready, then begin. And do have them do it the way you want them to do it, not what they think they should do. It's obvious they're not in the right mental state of mind to make decisions about what's healthy. And then again, I go back to, in that first year, 2 years of recovery, don't listen to anything they say. Only observe what they do. For many, many years, we as addicts have manipulated the situation. We've told you what you wanted to hear. We've apologized over and over again. We have done whatever it has taken to be able to maintain our use and continue the cycle of addiction, right? But actions will ultimately speak louder than words. Most importantly, seek your own personal counseling and support groups. This affects the family and the loved ones, sometimes in a much more devastating manner than it does the individual suffering from the disease of addiction. You need to be able to counsel with others that are going through the same experience that you are, just like we as addicts need to counsel with other addicts that are going through recovery. You need to get professional clinical help around certain issues that you're dealing with from a parental or a marital standpoint, it's extremely important that if you want to come out of this healthy, whether or not your loved one does, that you need to find your own help. So often we're like, it's them, right? And as the rescuer, that makes it great for me, right? I'm okay. Lex has the problem, right? So I naturally go into that facilitator, rescuer, fixer mode. And during that time, I'm suffering my own mental issues. So I highly recommend that you seek your own professional help. There is hope. There is a solution. Recovery from addiction is taking place every day. Millions of us are doing this, right? What we're not doing is we're not saying, yeah, I'll get into recovery if I can do it this way, if you give me this, if I'm allowed to do that. No, there is a very clear solution, and those of us that are in the solution do what we're told. Again, I go back to, if there's any negotiation, that person's not in recovery. That person's not ready. Those are controversial statements. You're going to hear many people tell you, well, we need to meet them where they're at. And we need to be able to be compassionate. And there are many pathways to recovery. And while there are, and many of them are a good start, I agree with Dr. Thurstone, MAT, medically assisted treatment or therapy, is a great start if there is a horizon. I have a daughter that was on methadone for 12 years and it did nothing because she did not work a program of recovery in conjunction with that. So it is a great way to wean an individual off of a substance as you build a recovery program. Anyone that tells you this person needs, with all due respect, anyone that suggests that an individual needs to be on medically assisted treatment, and this is only my opinion, for their lifetime, I would question that. I personally would question that because once an individual truly gets into recovery, they want to break free of whatever the addiction is, whether it's substance or process, whether it's cigarettes, caffeine, sex, drugs. Once you understand addiction and you enter into recovery from that, you do not want to be addicted or dependent on something else. And there is a solution with very strong recovery communities in our community. Let me be redundant. And there are many organizations that provide peer recovery support resources, coaching, and then the 12-step process. And then there are secular peer groups too. I believe in the spiritual peer group, but for those, if you have a loved one that just can't grasp that yet, get them into some sort of peer recovery community. Because only together can we overcome what individually we were unable to. Thanks so much.
Jeff, what's the process?
We've got a few minutes for questions. I want to make sure we get to those, but I want to just walk through real quick so I understand. I want to simplify it for myself. So you've got teenagers that are starting to use. You recognize that you found some pot in their room, something like that. One is you need to make sure that you're educated on what's happening. You need to make sure that you're caring and authoritative is the right word, that you're addressing these issues, that you're setting clear expectations, that this is not acceptable. You need to get both parents on board. That's important, that we're not dividing the family, that we're addressing this. And I think most importantly, that you're helping these young people have a sense of purpose. Like, well, I've got four young children, and I talk to them all the time, that God created you for something. You are here for a reason to do something really important. And this that you're getting into, this is a web of entanglement that's going to stop you from your full potential. Amen. Is that a good step when we're dealing with young people, Ken?
Yeah, absolutely. I think one of the things you hit on there, too, is all those future opportunities and what's out there that you're passionate about and what plans you have and the goals that you set, all of those things are huge protective factors that if we can help our young people keep those ends in mind. And the fact that use of these various substances get in the way of that opportunity. And Dr. Thurston described, the more you do it, the bigger the risks and the more consequences that may come from it. And so if we can keep those things in mind, absolutely, I think that's the right way to approach it.
Great. Now with adults. So we've got a coworker, we've got a cousin, family member, brother, spouse is struggling with these issues. Number one, we've got to make sure we're not enabling them, right? We're not continuing to allow them. We've got to set clear expectations for their lives as well, that this is not acceptable. You're my brother, you're my sister, or you're my spouse. We can't have you doing that. We can't be in an enabling mode where we're continuing to fund or give excuses or other opportunities that allow them to continue to do that. We've got to let them get to a place where they're humble enough to admit, and I think that was one of the first ones, that they're honest enough. I think, Peter, you brought this up in the 12-step program, that they're honest enough or humbled enough, they've hit that point where they need help. Because if we try to engage prior to that, Paul, I think this is what you were saying. They're going to give you a million different excuses, and they're not at a position where they really need that help if they're putting conditions on it, right? They really need to be at a place where they are at rock bottom, right? At that point, if they're ready, if they're finally at that point, then we get into a 30 to 90 day treatment program with a long-term sober living accountability program. Is that kind of how we do that? And how do they find information on that? How do we help our folks here know where a good 30 to 90 day program is, or a long-term accountability program?
Well, there's this cool new thing. It's called the internet. And no, I'm sorry, that was. There are many resources on the internet. My recommendation is to call several different places, figure out what their recovery structure is, what their payment structure is, and just do some research on the organization itself. You can also reach out to other professionals that refer and work closely in conjunction with those treatment centers. The challenge is, and you said it well, Jeff, how do we find a good one? Right, because there are so many today, and many of them are in that for-profit zone that are looking to make money. I would start with nonprofit treatment centers, ones that are usually associated with a hospital or some other reputable organization like Betty Ford, Hazelden, if they have that sort of connection. Dr. Thurston, how would you go about referring a client to a particular treatment center that you think is appropriate for that individual?
Yeah, I think I agree. I would give them a list of names, menu of options, ask them to call, and then make big decisions with their heart, right? And see which one has the best vibe for them.
Another way would be find other people that are in recovery. You can... Yeah. Usually if you go to peer recovery support groups, people are going to be willing to direct you to a good treatment environment. If you all go to your own support groups, whether that be Al-Anon or something similar, other folks there will be able to direct you as to where they sent their loved ones. It's a pretty well-knit community if you just dip your toe into it.
As a parent, it terrifies me, the idea of letting my child walk out without any support and knowing what they're going to face on that street. And they're going to be used and abused and ripped to shreds. How do you get past that? How do you, I'm struggling with that. How do you do that as a parent?
you don't ever get past it. Yeah. That's the thing, right? With the accountability piece, it has to come with love and compassion. You can't just be like, get out, you suck, or excuse my language, whatever that looks like. It has to be with love and compassion. And you have to know that ultimately you're doing the right thing, right? You have to know that in your heart. And that's why we seek support, so that others can tell us, that share with us their experience and how their loved ones have come back around and been okay. Secondarily, we have to have faith, right? We have to have faith that God or the universe or whatever it is you might believe in is going to do the right thing for our families. We also have to accept the fact that the sooner this happens, the sooner they may get to recovery. And the longer I stretch it out, the worse it's going to be for them. The final thing to remember is people that suffer from the disease of addiction are extremely resourceful. We find a way to survive, right? And we always hear about the overdose deaths and the drunk driving accident because we're a dirty laundry society. We want to hear about the bad, right? What you don't hear about is the millions of people that get into recovery. The millions of people, or let's just even say it's thousands, the thousands of people that come back to their family restored and healthy. That's not an exciting, dramatic story. You rarely hear that story. So more often than not, the case is going to be that the individual finds recovery, comes back, and restores a healthy family dynamic. But more often, you're going to hear about the overdose because that makes news.
Can I say one thing?
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, there's one book I wanted to leave you with too. Get Your Loved Ones Sober, Alternatives to Nagging, Pleading, and Threatening. So Get Your Loved Ones Sober, Alternatives to Nagging, Pleading, and Threatening. So one thing we shouldn't do is nag, plead, and threaten, right? That just doesn't help. That makes you want to drink more, right, to escape that. And it's by Myers. And the two basic premises: improve your own life, and number two, make sobriety more appealing than using. Right?
And
when you,
point.
Yeah.
Go ahead, please.
Yeah, no, it's a key point because why would you want to stop if you're facing the nagging, pleading, threatening, and it makes, you know, you want to have something better to look forward to. And I think also, Paul, did you mention Celebrate Recovery?
I did not, and thank you for mentioning that. Celebrate Recovery is an amazing Christian 12-step program that has phenomenal results. Thank you, Christian. I appreciate that.
Great. Questions? We have microphones, so wait. We've got a lot of people watching online, so wait till you get a microphone. We'll start over here with the hat. Hold on real quick, and we'll give you a microphone.
Yeah, my name is Jennifer. My husband is a recovering addict. He started his meth addiction when he was 11, early 80s. And I was that person, as Paul said, that didn't understand and told him, just stop. It shouldn't be that hard, just stop. You know. And then eventually I was able to give him a little bit of tough love and kick him out and say, you have to hit bottom. I can't do this anymore. And in the process, I found with myself that I was able to seek help for myself. And in return, it helped him as well. He is almost done with a 2-year recovery program at a nonprofit, Stout Street, here in Denver. Mm-hmm. And I think getting help for us is important as well. Amy and I are currently running the only Smart Recovery family meetings in Denver at Cedar. So we also have cards for that if you'd like to attend those meetings. My question is, what are any of your opinions on codependency?
Great question. Thank you.
That's a great question.
You want to start?
I'm going to kick it to the doctor.
Okay.
No, I was going to kick it to you, Paul.
This is codependency.
Yeah.
Does that? codependency is part of that personal disease that someone else has, that need to be needed, that need to be valued, that need to feel as though there is a mission in their life. And oftentimes the individual that's suffering becomes my mission, right? And if I can just fix you, I'm going to fix me. And we are going to live happily ever after. And I think that's what the book said we should do, right? So that's a very rudimentary explanation, and I'm sure Christian will give us a better one.
And there's codependency. Does anybody here have experience with codependency anonymous or any of those groups? No?
Yeah. Oh, you do? No. Where's our microphone?
All right. Any? Yes, go ahead. Hold on for the microphone real quick.
I'm one of those boring people. I've been sober for 36 years. What you're all clapping for me saving my own ass. Excuse me. I have two questions or comments. Firstly, nothing was mentioned about the fake marijuana, like Mr. Nice Guy's spice. It's cheap, but it's more dangerous than pot. Mm. So if you got a kid that says, oh, this is fake marijuana, it's good. Don't believe it. It can kill them faster than pot can. Number two, suppose one cannot afford a 30-day program. They're pretty expensive. What do we do? I knew what I did, but perhaps you have a suggestion. And then, okay, trying to think my third point. That's it.
I'll just comment on the K2 spice and synthetic marijuana. And Dr. Thurston, I don't know if you've done any research on that too, but yeah, those products often are sprayed with chemicals. You have no idea what's in them. And so, there's a lot of, and you've seen some spikes of overdoses and that take place and everybody using that same product. They're absolutely ones that one would want to stay away from. We haven't brought up any comments about vaping tonight either, and that as a potential pathway for use of nicotine products and other substances, which is absolutely a serious issue. That's, I think, overtaken in many ways some of the K2 and spice concerns that we've had that has become better managed by law enforcement. They were a little behind, but then caught up with it. But the vaping piece, we are still trying to figure out how to deal with. And that one, I think the data point out of the Healthy Kids Survey was 1 in 3 high school students had used a vaping product, an electronic cigarette or a Juul or what have you, and could be a variety of things in it. And honestly, we don't know much about the risks that come with it yet. There's not enough research out there. The only thing we do know is that there are some surveys out there that say that it is a better way to consume nicotine than a combustible cigarette for those that are smoking. That doesn't mean that it's the problem is that it's getting other people into smoking and using whether it's nicotine or other products. So while it may help those that are trying to quit smoking, it is introducing a whole new set of folks into this world.
I wanted to just point out the importance of civil society, the family, faith-based organizations, and nonprofit organizations in addressing these issues. You mentioned how expensive these for-profit recovery programs are, and they are. But for this organization and what Colorado Christian University stands for, we all know that the family is the number one the number one support group that's going to help anyone through any of these incredibly difficult challenges. Our faith-based organizations, if you get down into what used to be called Skid Row in Denver, right in the heart of it is Step Denver that Paul runs here, but there's also the Denver Rescue Mission. Now, that generally is an immediate shelter, but the Denver Rescue Mission also runs a crossroads center, which for those folks who get into it, offers a terrific recovery program, very high standards, and it is a great organization. Sadly, though, the Salvation Army, which also operated an incredibly effective program, had to close that down because they simply couldn't make it work financially. That's a real loss for our community. And Arapahoe House also is a detox center in Denver that really almost every recovery program would use. Unfortunately, they had to shut down. So in the midst of these incredible challenges, as Jeff pointed out, the rising level of deaths from opioid addiction, for some reason, these organizations are not getting the support that they need. But it really is important. If you get down into those neighborhoods, it's Samaritan House, Step 13, the Rescue Mission, it's St. Francis Center. You know, it's all these faith-based organizations that are really on the front lines taking care of this work.
And do you guys know if there's Medicaid or Medicare coverage on some of these? Paul, you're shaking your head. You're nodding your head. Is there some?
That's a great question, Toby, and thank you very much, because many, many people cannot afford treatment. Many folks go into the detox. They come out of detox, and they walk right into the 12-step rooms. That's primarily the way it used to be, wasn't it? You know, nowadays, many people find that a bit challenging because of the increased exposure to drugs and alcohol that our society has, right? Not that alcohol wasn't readily available everywhere, but marijuana, prescription pills, you know, as Kent brought up, vaping has become the number one delivery system for smoking pot now. Many people are vaping because it's healthier for me, right? And I still get high. But there are a number of programs that will take Medicaid or some other form of insurance. There are a number of them in which you can get scholarships for them. There are a number of foundations and other organizations that will give grants to individuals. That process, takes a little bit of time. Denver Health has a program, the TRT program. There are some options, and really it's about the dedication of the individual. If they are really ready and they jump through about a week and a half to 2 weeks worth of hoops, they can get into one of those treatment programs at low to no cost or using their Medicaid benefits.
We have time for one more question. We'll go right over here up in the front row.
Okay, my son is a heroin
addict. Hold on real quick. We have a microphone. Thanks.
My son is 22. He's a heroin addict. And we've been through West Pines. He's on Subutex. He's allergic to Narcan. He started out at church, trading pot with his friends at church 6 years ago. So we did all the things that you talked about. The codependency thing, one of our issues now is him in recovery or trying to get some help with the Medicaid, because we've searched through many different ways to get him help. Like you said, came out of West Pines, 2 weeks, give him Subutex. We now have 9 deaths from the overdose of heroin, fentanyl. These boys, I call them boys, are early 20s, in our group of friends, 9. We're in Jeffco. So I'm not exactly sure what I'm asking. Maybe it's a comment. Maybe we're in an emergency situation with these kids in these last few years. The codependency being, you're dead. You stop using the heroin. The kids think, oh, I can stop. They will stop a month, 2, 6 months, a year. They go back to the same dose they were using. They're overdosed, they're dead. So the codependency there is going to be different from maybe an alcoholic family. My family also, my parents, uncles, alcoholism there. But they live for a long time. Some recovered, some didn't. Some committed suicide because of it. They have PTSD problems. I don't know what I'm asking exactly. Is that there's an emergency situation with these kids, not just the education in the schools, the lectures, they miss out. I don't know. Do you have anything to add to that?
Help.
My son's roommate, he just didn't wake up one morning because he went back to the same dose he had been using. I think, Paul, I want to talk to you afterwards.
Sure.
Thank you for sharing.
Thank you.
It's very brave. We've got one last final comment. I know Dr. Newell had a handout. I'll let him make one last final comment real quick, and then we've got to wrap up here.
Thank you. You got it. Okay. We have a gold star panel up there. Thank you, Jeff. I think that these guys are fabulous. I learned a lot. Thanks for putting them together. Thanks for CU putting this, university here for putting this together. The Centennial Institute. A couple of comments, if I may. I think when a parent tries to discuss something with their kids and they don't have the data, they don't have the information, I think there's a little bit of a reluctance because they don't know if they're really prepared. There was a speaker that was here 3 years ago named Bill Bennett. Some of you may have been here for that. Terrific guy. This book was published by Bill Bennett in 2015. It's called Going to Pot, Why the Rush to Legalize America is Harming, to Legalize Marijuana is Harming America. If anybody wants to see the book, they're welcome to take a pic, maybe a picture with their phone or whatever. It's no longer in print, but it's available from Amazon for $6. And it is chocked full of data, 273 references. And I think the pot is an issue, as we've heard, not only a gateway drug, but it has serious issues itself. I'd like to wrap this up by just saying that I think, Jeff, you're going to have something they could tap into in terms of data for this book. From more about marijuana, I wanted to comment on that. And just say, I swear, being a physician, we know an ounce of prevention is worth a pound of cure. Mm-hmm. I'm old enough that some of the older folks here may, you know, identify with this. But when I was little, my dad was a physician in Oklahoma, and I remember, and some of you remember special conversations growing up. They never go away. This was one of them. My dad sat me down, he was a physician, and he said, Steve, this is non-negotiable. I was in grade school, in junior high back in those days. He said, because he would have addicts that would come to his office when they were closing, and he was very concerned about getting robbed and bumped off because they were desperate. And he had first had knowledge of what it was to deal with these people. And he said, Steve, never, never even try it. I remember that conversation like it was last night. And I'm just saying, those kind of conversations with someone with a skull as thick as mine, it gets through.
Yeah.
So don't be afraid to discuss it. Early and repeatedly.
Great. Thank you, Dr. Newell.
Thank you.
Can we give our speakers a round of applause? Friends, this will be our last distinguished lecture series before the election, and I wanted to let you know you are the first audience to see the brand new ballot guide from the Centennial Institute today. Hopefully this is helpful in making decisions with regards to all the issues we're facing on the ballot this year. And our next issue, our Distinguished Lecture Series, will be right after the election. It will include myself, John Andrews, Frank McNulty, the former Speaker of the House, and John Caldera, the head of the Independence Institute, as we explore what just happened in the election and what we need to do moving forward. So hopefully you'll join us on that for November 8th. But take this home with you. You're the first ones to see it. Thank you all so much for coming out. God bless you. We'll see you next time.
Thank you.
Good clean fun.
Wow.
This is always good fun.
Thank you.
Well done.